thank you guys for coming to this. I'm Jake Kennedy. I'm the Associate Director of Admission here at Mercersburg Academy. In addition to working in the admission office, I also work in the dorms. I live just off campus, and I help after school with our outdoor education program. And I'm about to start my fifth year here at Mercersburg, so I've been here for a few years now.
对，这里的话 ，Jack 老师给咱们做了一个自我介绍。今年呢是他在 Mercersburg 的第五年。然后他除了本身是这个招生办的副总监之外，他同时也是在宿舍担任 dorm parent 这样的一个职责。然后另外呢，他也是会负责学校的户外运动这一块的一些活动的。对，这就是老师的一个自我介绍。
A little bit about Mercersburg Academy. We were founded in 1893, so we actually just recently completed our 125th school year just a couple years ago. We're located in Pennsylvania in the Mid-Atlantic region of the United States. Just to give you a sense of where exactly that is geographically, we're in a pretty rural location, but we're only about an hour and a half away from Washington, D.C., an hour and a half away from Baltimore, then 3 hours away from Philadelphia, and about 4 hours away from New York City. Washington, D.C. and Baltimore are the two airports that our international students typically use. They're really big international hubs, and they're only a little over an hour away, so that's typically where our Chinese students will fly in and out of. We do have a really strong endowment of about $270. It's $270 million. It's one of the top 12 in the United States. So the school is in an extremely strong place financially. And this number is actually the updated number as of a couple weeks ago. So this is where our endowment stands, even after all of the economic turmoil that the country has faced. So we're still in a very strong place financially as a school. And then a few years ago, we recently completed a $300 million capital campaign to really solidify that solid financial standing as an institution.
这个是关于 Mercersburg 这个学校的一些基本介绍。学校是成立于1893年，然后在宾州附近。它距离华盛顿 DC 是一个半小时的一个开车距离，然后离这个 Baltimore 这个地方也是一个半小时。那绝大部分的国际学生也都是搭乘飞机、国际航班到这两个城市的大机场来进行到学校的这个距离的。然后学校呢，它一直在财政方面都是在整个美国都居于比较顶尖的一个位置。比如说像在这个校园基金这一块的话，它在全美的寄宿学校里面是排名前12的。然后最近的这个学校也刚刚完成了一个$3亿的一个竞标，所以说学校在财政这一块得到了一个非常稳定的来自校友和在校学生的一个支持。
Thank you. And a little bit about our student body. We're a medium-sized school. Our incoming class or our incoming student body for next year is right now around 434 students, which is fully enrolled for us. Of those students, we're about 85% boarding with a small population of about 15% day students. A lot of those day students actually spend most of their time on campus with their boarding student friends. And then we're about 21% international. And within our student body, we have 27 states represented and 36 countries represented. So we are an extremely global community, lots of different cultures and backgrounds here. And just to give you a sense of what our college matriculation looks like for this last year, which I'll go into a little bit more later on, we sent kids from this recent graduating class to Boston University, Brown, Columbia, Cornell, Dartmouth, Duke, Emory, Georgetown, NYU, Princeton, Stanford, UPenn, USC, and Vanderbilt. And if you see an asterisk by it, that means that one of our Chinese students actually is matriculating to that school. So really strong graduating class this year. They're a smart bunch, and they're going off to do some really cool things.
学校呢，它是一个中等规模的学校，全校有434名学生，那其中85%的学生是寄宿学生，所以这个也是很多咱们中国的家庭比较关注的，因为我知道很多孩子他爸爸妈妈希望把他们送到一个寄宿比例比较高的学校。那从这点上来看的话 ，Mercersburg 是一个比较好的一个选择。那学校的男女比例也是比较均衡的，其中52%就超过一点点，超过一半的学生是男孩子，然后48%的学生是女生。那国家的这个国际学生的比例呢是21%，说明这个学校它的国际学生的这个比例也是一个比较合理的一个区间。那全校园呢有来自36个国家的学生，然后有就是整个美国的话有来自27个州，所以说这个学校它确实是在多样化这一块的话它是做的比较好的。然后刚才也有说到这个学校它在今年的大学录取这一块它也是非常亮眼的一个成绩。刚才那一个页面它是有显示就是咱们的中国孩子他被哪一些学校录取了，因为现在已经到下面那个页面了，我们刚才如果大家有看到的话，就比如说有那个像纽约大学，然后波士顿大学、普林斯顿等等，都是咱们中国的家庭都会挺向往的一些学校。
Thank you. Yeah, and to talk a little bit about academics here at Mercersburg. We have about 170 course offerings in a given year, which is an astounding number of classes to choose from here during your time. Within all those offerings, we do have two unique capstone courses that is a requirement of all students. You're required to do one of the two options before you graduate. And then we also have a number of advanced offerings and classes, as well as independent studies. If you feel like you've maxed out our own offerings here, you can actually get together with a faculty member who will serve as your advisor to create a curriculum that suits your level of expertise and your level of interest. And we have kids who do that every year and who do some really cool things with those independent studies. We have a 4-to-1 student to faculty ratio. So for every 4 students, there's 1 faculty member. So it's a really tight-knit community here. There's a lot of adult support, a lot of mentors who are here to look after you. And then we, of course, offer course offerings in all the traditional courses that you'll typically find in any kind of liberal arts school. And for foreign language, we have 5 different offerings: Latin, Chinese, German, Spanish, and French. German is actually a pretty unique offering. There aren't a whole lot of schools in the U.S. anymore who do offer German classes. And we also have a full robotics program that you can take for credit, as well as extracurricularly.
学校的话有170门课可以供学生去选择，所以这个选择的范围还是非常广的。然后其中呢，有两个是 Mercersburg 这个学校非常有他们自己独特的一个特点的，他们自己的一个特色项目。然后呢，也会有包含一些独立的学习，还有更进一步的课程选择。然后学生和老师的师生比是4:1，所以这个比例也是非常低的。那每一个孩子呢都可以在学校得到足够的一个关注。那刚才有说到这个学校它在选课方面有特别多的选择，有高达170个。那其中Jack 老师他就特别举了一些例子，就比如说在这个外语方面，那学校有开设5门外语，比如说有拉丁、中文、法语、德语，还有这个西班牙语。其中德语这一块是不是特别多的学校有这样的一个选择，所以这个也是 Mercersburg 它在外语学习这一块比较好的一个资源。那另外还有在这个艺术、纯艺术，还有这个体育以及宗教这一块的课程可以供选择。那另外呢，有一些孩子他如果说对这个机器人这一块比较感兴趣的话，那也是可以提供一个完整的机器人这样的一个项目，而且这个是可以加入学分的。
Thank you. Now, being a boarding school, we're so much more than just a school in the sense of what you'd find in the classroom. you are expected to have some level of involvement in the community outside of the classroom here at Mercersburg. And there are a ton of different ways in which you can involve yourself in the community. As far as extracurriculars go, we have 27 different sports with 45 teams. So we, for a lot of those sports, we have teams at the varsity level, the junior varsity level, and even the thirds level. So those are ideal. The thirds level is ideal for a lot of students who have interest in a sport but might not have any experience. That's a great way for them to get some exposure and practice in an actual competitive environment without having to worry about trying out and getting cut on a junior varsity or varsity team. So we make some of our sports very accessible for students who have interest in them. As far as the arts go, we offer 4 annual theater productions. One is a big musical in the winter, which is always a highlight of the school year. This past year, we did Mamma Mia. And then we also have 3 dance productions, one in the fall, one in the winter, and one in the spring. And the spring one is actually all student choreography. And they put on some fantastic work in our dance program. If you're a musician, we have 2 a cappella groups that you can join if you're a singer, as well as just your general choir, which sings in chapel services and special school ceremonies. We have a string ensemble, as well as a competitive concert band. The concert band isn't for beginners, actually. You're required to have some level of musical experience to be a member of it, because they do compete, and they're really good. So all the musicians in our concert band are pretty experienced, or have some level of experience. Outdoor education, if sports or arts aren't your thing, you can spend the afternoons outside doing activities like skiing, hiking, as well as mountain biking. And students do that every year. It's not hard to start a club here at Mercersburg. All you need is an idea and some friends who will join, and then you can get a club up and running if you're interested in something. We have a pretty extensive travel program here. You will have a ton of different opportunities to travel globally if you'd like, with our school. And then we also have a competitive RoboCup team, which has competed at the international level every year for the last 10 years. So if robotics is an interest to you, we have an expansive program here.
那课堂学习之外呢，那学校它在体育、艺术还有音乐方面的发展也是非常成熟的。比如说在体育方面，全校有总共27个运动可以供学生去选择。那学校的话有45个校队，然后也包括一些初级校队和我们说预备校队吧。所以说从这个数字上可以看到，学校它是非常重视体育教育的。那在音乐这一方面的话，那学校它有4年度的戏剧制作，然后其中有一个是音乐剧。那在这个舞蹈这一块的话，学校有3年度的舞蹈大片制作。所以从这个不管是戏剧、音乐剧还是舞蹈这一块的制作来看的话，那这个学校它确实是文体于各方面都非常全面的在发展，然后给孩子也有更多的体验不同这个活动的机会。那学校在户外的教育这一块的话，老师刚才举了3例子，一个是这个徒步，户外的徒步，然后另外呢就是冬季的这个滑冰，还有就是在利用 Mercersburg 它的这个先天独厚的一个地理位置的优势，它会有这个山地骑车这样子的一个户外教育的机会，那也是很多我们以往的孩子觉得很兴奋的地方。那在学校就是已有的这个社团之外呢，学校也鼓励孩子们去经营，甚至说是自己去创办一些自己学校没有但是自己又很感兴趣也希望能够影响他人的一些社团。所以全校目前有45个学生自己组织和运营的社团和组织。那除此之外呢，学校它也会非常看重我们每一个学生他在国际化、国际视野这一块的发展，所以学校它会组织学生去到 五个大洲去参加一些比如说交换项目啊，或者说全球视野的一些旅游项目等等。然后另外刚才老师也特别提到了学校在机器人这一块的校队是非常有竞争性的，他们也会参加一些国际性或者说国内性质的这样子的一个比赛。那这个也是对于我们刚才有说到吸引了很多就是对机器人这一块很感兴趣的学生。 Thank you.
To tell you a little bit about our facilities, and I'm actually going to show you some pictures of them specifically here in just a second. We're lucky to be a school with really state-of-the-art and top-notch facilities. We have an extremely generous alumni base here who are generous to the school and give us plenty of resources to give our students the best facilities that that schools have to offer. In the last few years, we've poured $9 million worth of renovations into our athletic building specifically. We have 10 playing fields as well as one artificial turf field. Mercersburg is a huge campus. It's over 300 acres. So a lot of that land is where there aren't academic buildings. It's devoted to land for athletic and practice facilities, actually fields, practice fields. A couple of years ago in 2017, we opened our brand new $12 million field house, which I'll show you in just a second. If you play squash, we have a 10-court squash center for our squash team. We have a 14-court tennis pavilion. And then our most exciting addition to campus in 2019, this past fall, we just opened our brand new 16.5 million dollar aquatic center. It's a full Olympic size swimming pool, 50 meter lanes. Our students were lucky enough to get one season out of it before they had to leave in the spring. So the facilities here are really impressive. And if you want to go ahead and translate that before I move on to the arts, you can go right ahead.
那学校在设施这一块的话，因为我们刚才有提到财力特别的雄厚，所以学校在校园的设施这一块，它也是不遗余力的给学生打造尽可能丰富的、尽可能好的这样子的一个校园设施。比如说在运动这一块的话，学校它也是在去年，就是2019年的秋季，刚刚新开了一个水上运动中心，然后也是斥巨资打造了一个这么现代化，然后设施非常齐全的一个这样的水上运动中心。然后除此之外呢，在网球、壁球，还有这个校园操场等等运动场各个方面，学校它的硬件设施都是非常完美的。那另外也在这个艺术方面呢，学校也是在比如说这个陶艺工作室，然后音乐还有歌唱等等，就各种各样的这样的设施方面，也是给学生提供了很多的支持。那不管是对音乐还是对艺术还是对这个运动感兴趣的学生，都会觉得在 Mercersburg 能够得到非常大的一个支持。
Thank you. And as far as the arts go, our arts facilities are equally impressive as our athletic facilities. We opened a $26 million art center in 2007. So it's just a little over 10 years old at this point, but it looks brand new still. Inside it, we have two dance studios for our dancers and our dance program. We have a 600-seat professional theater. It's got two balconies. You really do feel like you're performing on Broadway when you're on that stage. We have a black box studio theater for our smaller productions. We also have a maker's lab and an innovation lab for our students to create things and take classes that are a little less traditional. And then we also have digital arts labs. We have a ceramic studio and painting and drawing rooms, and then as well music and vocal rooms for students to rehearse in.
对，这里老师的话又给了更多的一些细节，比如说学校光是这个舞蹈的这个训练场就有两个，然后它也有非常专业的这个戏剧院，戏剧院的话，它能够容纳600个观众。那除此之外呢，学校在这个这个 makers space 还有电子 电子艺术、艺术实验室等等各个方面也是有很多的这个设施可以给到学生的。
Thank you. And some pictures of our facilities here. On the left, this entire building on the left is, that is our athletic complex. So that's where our swimming pool is. That's where our track is. That's where our basketball courts and wrestling facilities are. And then that big building on the left, that's our field house, which you can see the interior here on the right. It's got a 200 meter track inside it, and that's where our indoor track program practices every winter.
对，这个两个图片呢，就是给大家的一个俯瞰图。左边呢是从是户外的一个运动场地，然后右边这个是室内的一个运动场，都会看到是非常的气势磅礴。所以确实学校在设施这一块是斥巨资，希望给学生带来一个比较好的体验。
Thank you. Yeah, and here's our brand new Lloyd Aquatic Center, which opened in the fall. As I said, it's an Olympic-sized swimming pool with 50-meter lanes, and that's where our swimming team practices and competes. And it's actually our swimming team is nationally ranked pretty consistently every year, so it's a highly competitive program.
那学校的这个在游泳方面还有跳水方面也是学校的一个传统强项，所以也可以从这个图片上看到这个设施啊还有各个方面都是非常非常先进和现代化的。我们很多孩子也是到了学校之后去敢于去尝试这种新的一种体育运动，因为有些孩子可能去之前在这个水上运动方面不是特别感兴趣或者说不是很擅长，然后在这样的一个环境里面他们也愿意去多做一个尝试。
These are basketball courts on the left. We compete in a league with the Hill School, Lawrenceville, Petty, and Blair. And then these are our squash courts on the right.
像左边的话，这个是他们的这个篮球场地，右边的话是壁球场地。学校呢也经常会跟一些有校去进行这个PK 去打比赛，比如说有时候会跟 Blair， 有时候会去跟这个Lawrenceville， 都是一些比较顶尖的美高，也在离学校不远的地方，会跟这些学校去进行友谊赛。
And then lastly, these are our practice fields. We have 10 practice and playing fields, which include soccer, lacrosse, field hockey, and baseball fields, as well as an artificial turf field.
那除在这个图片上有显示的这一些运动场地之外，那学校它在这个比如说曲棍球啊、足球，包括橄榄球等等各个方面，他们都有自己非常好的一个体育设场地设施。
And real quickly, I'm actually going to close out of my PowerPoint right here and take you to our virtual tour, which you can find on our website. I'll show you how to get there in just a second. But this is our arts facility, which I told you about earlier. It's modeled after the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. And when you walk inside, this is what our theater looks like. It's a pretty big space, as I told you. It seats over 600 students. At 600 people, so our entire student body and faculty, the community can fit in here pretty easily. And this is what it looks like from a seat in the balcony.
对，刚才我们有提到，就是学校有一个特别现代化的、很专业的一个可以容纳600个听众的戏剧院。所以说，现在我们可以通过这个云直播吧，来看一下这个。戏剧院它在里面，所主戏剧院的内外是怎么样的一个设施？可以从这个图从这个视频上可以看到。
I really encourage you guys to look at this at some point when you get the chance. It is a virtual tour of our entire campus, so you can go into any building and look around. I'll show you a couple of others. This is our dining hall. Actually, no, that's not our dining hall. Right next door, here's our dining hall. This is also where our student center is, just below it. So this is where a lot of our students hang out during the day when they don't have class. this is the mail room. So this is where students will have mail and packages delivered. And then just upstairs, you have our dining hall here. It's a really large space. We eat meals as a community every day. We can fit the entire community in here. And all of our meals are family style. So students sit with different groups of peers, as well as faculty at their lunch tables, as well as some dinners every day.
这里我们展示的是学校的食堂，在就餐的时候呢，学生会和他们的同学还有老师坐在一起，可以看出这个设置非常的像一个家庭一样，大家可以一边就餐一边去讨论今天的一些生活和学习上遇到的问题，所以是非常温馨的一个感觉。
And then I'll give you a sense of what a typical dorm looks like. This is where all of our freshmen, our ninth grade boys live. Tippett Hall, it's typically two guys to a room. And the rooms are big enough to bunk your beds if you want and put a TV and couch in. But yeah, typically two students to a room. Every student has a bed, a dresser, and a desk and study area. And yeah, the way rooming works, to pick your roommate, before you come to Mercersburg over the summer, you fill out a form that asks you questions like, do you like the room hot or cold? Do you like to wake up early or late? Do you go to bed early or late? Things like that. And then we compare all those surveys and we'll put you together with somebody who's compatible for you. But every year after that, you're able to pick your own roommate, whether it's a friend or somebody else who lives in the dorm.
我们现在看到呢是学校的宿舍。那值得一提的就是这个 Mercersburg 它的宿舍曾经上榜过全美的寄宿高中十家宿舍之一。所以我们从这个图片上可以看到，这个学校它在宿舍这一块也是设施非常好的。它比传统的就比一般的美高的宿舍是要大的。一般情况下，一个宿舍会住两个孩子。那学校呢，就比如说我们在去九年级开学之前，学校就会让每一个孩子去填一个表格。那这个表格里面就会去要求学生去写我们是什么样类，就是在住宿这一块什么样类型的人，就比如说我们是晨型人还是晚型人，就什么时候怎么样的一个睡眠的风格，还有这样生活的习惯。那学校会在看到了我们递交过去的这个表格之后，给我们去选择比较适合，就是在生活习惯上睡眠习惯上比较搭配的这样子的一个室友。那等到孩子们已经到了十年级、十一年级之后呢，那学生就会选择，就是有权利选择自己比较喜欢的室友，就基本上孩子们会倾向选择自己的朋友来做自己的室友。
Thank you. And then I'll take you inside the ninth and tenth grade girls' dorm. It looks pretty much the same. Very similar size room, similar configuration, except the beds are not bunked. This is the other configuration you'll find for a room where it's two beds just side by side. And of course, they all have their own desks and study spaces as well.
我们现在看到的是九年级和十年级的女生宿舍，也是两个孩子共用一个宿舍。它的空间也是足够的大，每一个学生都有自己的床，然后也有自己独立学习的这个书桌。对，所以这个和男生宿舍一样，也是空间非常大，然后两个孩子共用一个宿舍。
Thank you. Yeah, so that's a little bit about our campus. I'll show you how to get to that page in just a second. But to continue on here, I'm going to tell you a little bit about our college counseling program. I told you a few years ago, we completed a $300 million capital campaign, and a lot of that money was allocated to go into our college counseling department to improve that office in the process of placing kids in colleges. So we have six full-time college counselors, which is a really big size office for a medium-sized school. it makes a nice ratio. So no more than 25 seniors are assigned to a college counselor, which means your senior year, you're going to get a lot of individualized one-on-one attention from your college counselor as you look at colleges and universities. You're actually assigned your college counselor in the day you arrive on campus. So if you come in to Mercersburg in the ninth grade, you'll receive your college counselor in the ninth grade. If you come in 10th grade, you'll get them in 10th grade. Regardless, the process starts when you arrive. And that's just so that the college counselor can get a good sense of who you are and you guys can really establish that relationship so that by the time your senior year arrives, that relationship has already been established. They know who you are. They have a good sense of what school is going to be a good fit for you. So you can spend a lot of your 11th grade and senior year focusing on that rather than starting the process with your college counselor in 11th grade. And in addition to having to look at colleges, also establishing that relationship and getting and getting to know one another. So that all happens very early. And I'll let you go ahead and translate that before I continue.
Thank you. 学校呢，它在这个大学的升学指导这一块也是付出了很多的这个投入的。就比如说学校它有六位大学的升学指导，那最有特色的地方就是它每一个孩子在刚到学校的第一天起，他就会被分配一个升学指导。这个是在全美不是应该算不，即使不能算仅有的话，也是非常少数的几个学校可以做到的。因为绝大多数的美高，它因为升学指导这个力量相对来说没有那么的完备，所以基本上是11年级和12年级的学生，他们有比较多的机会去接触到这个升学指导。可是 Mercersburg 这个学校，它因为很看重大学规划这一块对一个学生的影响力，特别是对于九年级和十年级的学生，很多孩子他们也需要在这两年的时间去更好的去了解自己，去了解大学。所以说学校在这一块的话，他会做得非常好。他给九年级、十年级，就不管我们什么时候哪一个年级去到学校，那开学第一天起，学生就会被分配一个升学指导。那学生就会有机会跟这个指导有长达三年或者说四年的一个接触。那到了大学申请的这个时候呢，升学指导对学生的各个情况就已经算是了如指掌了。那不管是对于专业的确定、专业的这个建议，还是大学的建议，都会能够做到比较量身定造这样子的一个效果。那给一些数据吧，就比如说学校的话，他给每一个升学指导他负责的十二年级申请的学生是不会超过25位，那这个数字在绝大部分的这个美高里面也算是比较低的了。那从这个大学录取的结果来看的话，也是每年有平均85%的学生能够被最具竞争力的一些学校，全美的学校录取。那刚才也有提到，像2019年的大学录取的情况也是非常喜人的。就比如说学生他们有去到这个像康奈尔呀、杜克呀、埃默里啊、波士顿大学，还有这个 UCLA， 就是 UC 洛杉矶分校，还有这个宾大，这个乔治城大学等等，都是非常好的一些大学，这个被他们录取了。
85% of Mercersburg seniors are accepted into the Barron's most competitive colleges in the United States. Earlier in that previous slide, I showed you what some of our 2020 college matriculation looked like. But right here, this is what our 2019 college matriculation looks like. So you can see pretty consistently we are sending students to some of the top schools, Georgetown, Vanderbilt, Cornell, Duke, Emory, Boston, UCLA, and UPenn.
Yeah, I have translated that just now.
Oh, perfect. Great. And one of the things we implemented in 2015, actually, to improve our college counseling program was a test prep program. So this is something that's included in the Mercersburg tuition. It's not an added expense that you have to get on your own when you come here. It's provided by the school. So we have SAT and ACT prep for all 11th grade students. It's an expensive program, $200,000 paid for by the school. the way it works is you will take a diagnostic test for the ACT or the SAT to figure out which one you're the most successful at and best at, because they are two very different tests. And that's the one that you're going to focus entirely on, rather than taking both the ACT and the SAT a bunch of different times. Our tutors will help you focus on one of them. And in that process, you'll get 10 to 12 sessions, tutoring sessions with outside tutors. We use an outside test prep group that comes to campus and also does them virtually. And since implementing this program, we've seen just stellar results. Our SAT average score has gone up by 150 points. And then our ACT average composite score went up from 25 to 30. So 30 is now our average ACT score since implementing this program.
那值得一提的就是说，学校它在考培这一块也给学生非常大的一个支持，他们也是仅少的一些学校当中免费给十一年级及以上的学生去提供 SAT 或者 ACT 的这个考试辅导的。那这个后面的这个也是学校他们的基金会在全程支撑的，学生对于学生来说是完全免费。那学校是怎么做的呢？学校它会在培训之前给学生做一个 ACT 或者 SAT 的一个测试，来看一下这个孩子他比较适合去考哪一门考试。这个也确实挺凑巧的，跟咱们 Foundation 在我们的大学申请辅导这一块的会做的一个工作是一样的。我们也是会给我们自己的孩子在确定到底是做 SAT 还是 ACT 考培之前，给学生做一个测试，来看哪一种题型的这种考题会更适合咱们的孩子。那确定好了之后呢，学校他就会给这些学生提供10到12节的一个辅导课。那有些家长就会问说，那这个上课的老师是来自哪里？那上课的老师学校他出了为了这个出分的效果，他们其实用的是校外的一些辅导机构，以保证这个出分，因为他们都是会非常专业在从事这一块的，所以从出分效果这一块就有一个比较好的保证。那也是用数据说话。那 SAT 的话，基本上学生在参加了这个辅导之后有150分，平均下来有150分的这样的一个提分。那 ACT 呢，学校基本上是有一个5分的这样的一个提分效果。那值得一提的就是说目前学校在 ACT 这一块学生的平均分是有达到30分，但以往的话是只有25分。所以说这个引用校外专家在考试培训这一块给自己的学生，我觉得学校做的还是不遗余力的在帮助孩子的，而且效果也不错。
All right, now kind of the big elephant in the room, COVID-19. I know this is at the forefront of everyone's minds right now. There are a lot of questions, I know, and I'll go ahead and share with you what I'm able, because it is still a developing situation here in the United States. So we're kind of evaluating things every day as they develop. But Pennsylvania, where Mercersburg is, we're starting to very slowly reopen. Mercersburg has been closed for about 3 months now. Our students left for spring break in late February and never came back. They've been home ever since. And as soon as this all started, the school immediately established a task force that was tasked with looking at what it's going to look like when we do reopen. Now within that task force, we have a group of faculty, as well as outside medical experts, disease experts, government officials, other experts in the private sector who are helping us establish a plan and protocol for returning to work and returning to school safely.
那因为现在也是在新冠状病毒这样的一个疫情的影 影响之下，很多家长都非常关心学校是怎么样去应对这个疫情的。那学校它已经关闭了3个月了，那学生从春假离校之后，那现在基本上都是没有返校的。学校也在利用这段时间去积极的配合相关部门去思考，那等到学生返校之后，学校应该采取什么样的一个措施去尽量的保护学生的一个安全。那所以学校现在也是在咨询了各方的这个专业人士之后，这专业人士就包括了一些医疗人士啊、医务人士，还有就是政府的相关的这个医务部门的人员吧，就是各方都在帮助学校去思考这个问题，尽量做到就是说学生在返校之前和返校之后，学校在这一块能够保证学生的各方面的安全。
As of now, we are planning to be back on campus in the fall. That's what we're hoping for. That's what we're really staying optimistic for. But we're planning for every scenario. And our head of school is going to make a specific announcement about what the fall is actually going to look like sometime around July 1st, so about a month from now. And that'll give us a lot more clarity as to whether or not we are fully on campus. We're also looking at virtual scenarios, virtual hybrid models in the event that, for example, international students can't make it back to campus for some reason. We'll be ready to provide them with a virtual experience, hopefully only temporarily. And that's what our teachers are going to be spending most of their summer doing. Even though we continue to hope that we will be back on campus in person in the fall, our teachers are going to be spending most of this summer preparing virtual curriculum and further developing a virtual curriculum to have ready to go for the fall in case it's needed.
学校现在对这个疫情之下的一个乐观估计，就是说在今年秋季的时候，各个学生他都能够顺利的返校，这个是一个乐观的估计。那在此同时呢，学校他也在因为这个情况确实是不可预估，所以学校也在做各方面的一个预案。那也不排除说，如果情况发展的不是很好的话，那学生或者说国际学生是没有办法在今年秋季的时候顺利返校的。那在这样的情况下，学校他们也是在利用现在和整个暑假的一个时间，在比如说课程的开发上，去看是否有可以用这个网络教学的一个方式提供给学生或者说是国际学生。那每一个老师每一个教研组也在这一块不遗余力的去思考怎么样可以让学校的这个课程尽可能完善的提供给各个孩子。那所以说不管是什么样的一个状态，学校他们都是在非常努力的去寻找一个最佳的一个契合点吧，来配合好我们的学生。所以在这一块的话，家长不用太担心，因为学校他在这一块确实是已经考虑的非常多了，有在做各种各样的预案。基本上在7月1号的时候可以把这个具体的一个学校的一个方案正式发布给各个家庭。
Thank you. Our teachers had to pivot very quickly this past spring to adopt a virtual model and totally transform their in-person curriculum to a virtual model, which I'm sure many of you guys experienced in China yourselves. But the success of our students was at the center of it the entire time. What happened was so far out of their control that we were not going to let any of our students fall behind or fail because of it, because of how much was out of their control. So our teachers remained extremely flexible for all of our students, especially of those who live internationally and were on the other side of the world when many of our classes were happening. They were not required to attend. All classes were recorded so they could visit them later. But so many of them did. Even though they would be staying up till 1 or 2 a.m. Going to class and going to school, because it allowed them to stay connected to the community and being there with their peers and with their friends allowed them to maintain that connection. So even though we made it optional, a lot of international students still attended their classes in person, virtually with their peers. We changed the homework policy and removed all late penalties for late work because so many students were having to adjust their schedules and their time zones and their sleep schedules, whatever it may have been. We removed the late penalty for students who turned in late work. And then teachers also remained available as needed, just in a Zoom call from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. And students could log in for whatever reason within those hours to get extra help. And a lot of the students who took advantage of those times were our international students who may have missed some of those classes that happened too late for them. That two-hour window was a great time for them to connect with their teachers and catch up on anything they may have missed. And to be perfectly honest with you, our students adapted so well, and they really thrived in this environment. And I think it's a testament to how flexible our teachers were. There was actually a big push by the students to go to a pass-fail model for the spring. But we decided not to do that because we saw how well the students were adjusting, that we knew it wasn't in their best interest for them. And that proved to be true when they all eventually did succeed in our virtual model and finished well. The need for pass-fail wasn't necessary, and that's a testament to our students' resilience and their ability to be flexible and adjust to something like this so quickly.
从传统的线上教学转变到现在的网络教学，其实不管是对于孩子还是对于老师来说都是一个挑战。那学校也非常开心的看到，不管是学校的学生还是老师，在这一方面都做得非常的好，非常的灵活。那比如说老师的话呢，他们有做到一些调整，就比如说老师他会把所有的课程都录制下来，这样子的话就可以去满足那一些因为时差或者其他的原因没有办法按时的出现在这个网络课堂的学生，之后这个老师他会把录制的这个课程以链接的方式发送给这个学生，那学生他可以在他自己的一个比较适合的时区的情况下去补上这个课程。那另外呢，之前学校他在课程作业这一块有非常严格的一个体制，就是如果说学生晚交作业的话是会有一定的惩罚的，但因为现在也是在一个比较特殊的情况下，有考虑到学生他可能在不同的时区，然后有时候他也可能要面对一些其他不同的问题需要去解决，所以也是学校在这一块采用了一个比较灵活的处理方式。那之前在这个线下教学上比较严格的这个如果迟交作业的一些惩罚措施，在这一块就开始变得比较灵活，学校开始会采用一些因地制宜啊，然后比较个性化的一些处理方式去面对这样的一个情况。那从学生的角度来看的话，学校也是非常开心的看到很多学生，他虽然目前这个状态确实是比较难在课堂的一个正常的时刻按时出席课堂的，就比如说很多时候是在这个学生本身时区的凌晨两三点钟才会有这个课，那很多孩子他还是会宁愿熬夜去参加这个课，为什么呢？就是因为他觉得在这样子的一个情况下，他能够看到自己的老师能够跟自己的学生同学去相互交流，他们觉得这样子是一个对他们来说比较好的一个方式，能够让他们跟他们的朋友跟他们的这个老师保持一个比较正常的一个互动吧。对，所以说从这点上看的话，也是学校他会觉得自己的学生做得非常好的地方，也体现了 Mercersburg 他在培养孩子的时候的一些核心的理念，这些学生都做得非常的好。
Maintaining community was obviously a top priority for us. We wanted to make sure our students felt like they were a part of the school and connected to the community, even though they weren't actually here. And we were worried that that was going to be difficult to do, but students, they continued to find ways to stay connected to the community. The ways that we did it as a school, We've continued to have students meet with their advisors every week. And we also established a daily newsletter that the school sent out to parents and alumni and students and faculty that talked about what was going on both at school, but in students' lives virtually. And students were asked to share what they were doing at home and how they were staying busy and what hobbies they may have picked up during this time. All that was shared in the virtual newsletter. And then we also hosted things like virtual game nights, virtual trivia nights, bingo nights over Zoom, and clubs continued to meet virtually as well. So we made sure our students had opportunities to remain engaged in the community, even though they weren't here on campus.
因为学校呢，它是一个非常重视人文关怀，还有社区、校园建设、校园文化建设这样子的一个学校，他们非常看重人与人之间的这个关系。那不管是同学和同学之间，还是同学和老师之间，各种各样的关系都是学校它在非常努力的去维持的。即使说这个学生他可能目前不在这个学校，那通过什么样的方式呢？就学校它还是会要求。学生和这个老师要以每一个星期为单位进行一个网上的一个见面，然后在这个会议上呢，学生可以跟这个老师去交流他在学习上啊，或者说在生活上有没有什么新的一个心得，那也会安排就是学生和学生之间的一个互动和交流，那学生可以分享他们在自己的国家或者说其他的国家他们有没有重拾一些什么新的爱好，然后参加了一些哪些新的活动等等。然后之前学校就是学生他在学校比如说有举办一些社团的话，那这些社团的成员也会以一个就是在线交流的方式去交流他们在这个社团相关的兴趣啊，或者说项目方面，他们有哪些新的进展？就学校会通过各种各样的方式，让即使是在这个疫情期间，学生和学生之间和学生和老师之间的各种各样的关系，还是像之前一样保持的非常的一个紧密。
Great, thank you. Lastly, the Mercersburg Promise, and if you take away from anything away from this presentation, it's this. Mercersburg is a school that's number one, we're going to challenge you. You're expected to work hard here, and you're expected to push yourself and step outside of your comfort zone, absolutely. But number two, we're going to support you along the way. You're not going to be on your own here. You're not going to be expected to fend for yourself in the classroom and struggle alone. There are so many resources on campus, and we're going to be there to help you along the way. Getting support at Mercersburg, getting help in a class, isn't something that's frowned upon. It's encouraged. Our valedictorian this year, who's going to Duke, he talked in a speech on campus this year about how he's the valedictorian because of his ability to go out and ask for help and seek support. So that's encouraged and necessary for success here at Mercersburg. Number three, we're going to accept you for who you are. A lot of students ask, like, what kind of student are you looking for to come to Mercersburg? And the truth is there is no type of Mercersburg student. We have one of everything here, and no matter who you are or what your interests are, our community is going to welcome you with very open arms. And then number four, we're going to connect you. Mercersburg has a vast alumni base, and the Mercersburg experience doesn't end with your graduation here. Our alumni base stays connected to each other as well as to the school. And I mean it when I say that it's a community for life. You'll always have a home here, and you'll always be a part of the Mercersburg family should you choose to come here.
那最后呢，老师有介绍说，Mercersburg 这个学校它是什么样的一个学校呢？如果要用四个词来形容的话，那第一个词会是 challenge， 就是挑战。那挑战体现在哪一些方面？就不管是说在学术方面，还是说在对这个一个人的 性格养成方面，对于孩子来说，学校都会提供这样的挑战，因为孩子的他在目前这个阶段，他是需要有更多的动力去更好的去完善自己的，所以学校在这方面也提供各种各样的不管是运动还是艺术还是音乐，甚至说在学术方面各方面的一个挑战给到孩子，那孩子能够看到自己希望能够变成的那个样子之后，他会有一个动力，有一个方向去不断的发展和成熟自己，所以这是第一个就挑战。那第二个就是 support， 就是学校他会在各个方面给学生提供支持。那比如说刚才有提到的在设施方面，学校它有非常好的各方面的设施，那从设施上学校它是会提供给每一个学生他想要去在哪一个方面更好的发展自己，学校都会有这方面的一个支撑，师资上面的支撑和设施方面的支撑给到这个孩子。那这个是在硬件方面的。那软件方面呢，学校它也会非常非常看重这个对于学生在精神方面精神层次方面的一个养成的培养吧，会让学生觉得虽然说他会碰到很多的挑战，但是他不会是一个人孤军奋战，他不管什么时候学校的这个老师啊还有同学都是在他旁边的，都会给他提供孩子们会需要得到的一个帮助。所以这个是学校他在软件和硬件上面可以给学生提供的支持。那第三个呢，就是学校会他欢迎各种各样类型的学生，因为有很多家长他在不管是在入学之前还入学之后，可能会问到学校的一个问题，就是Mercersburg 这个学校他喜欢什么样的学生，什么样的学生是对于学校来说比较适合的。其实这个答案没有一个固定的，因为学校他欢迎各种各样类型的学生，没有一个固定的类型的学生说是这个学校他比较喜欢的，因为学校他会尊重有各个宗教信仰各个兴趣爱好各种生活方式学习方式的学生，只要说这个学生他能够给这个校园群体带来不一样的东西，那 Mercersburg 这个学校都欢迎这个孩子。所以学校也希望说学生通过在学校的这个学习能够更加坦然地接受自己，我们是什么样的一个人，那我们接受自己同时把自己变得更好。那第四个呢，学校刚才有说到就是在联系连结这个方面，那学校它拥有一个非常强大的校友系统，很多孩子他毕业之后并没有说真正的就跟这个学校脱离关系了，他还是会在这个校友系统里面非常非常积极的参加一些活动。所以说很多的学生他在离校之后还是会很感恩学校的一个教育吧，所以他们在这个校友活动这一块会非常积极的参与。那这个也是学校培养学生时候会不断渗透给学生的一个理念，就是咱们就算离开了学校，那 Mercersburg 这个精神咱们还是在的。那我们学校也是在人文啊还有就是校园包括社区建设社区的文化建设这一块是非常看重的。那这个也是很多从学校毕业之后的孩子他们会反馈过来的一个点，就是学校他很看重校友活动的这个参与和建设吧，然后校友也愿意在离校之后进一步的去反馈学校。
Thank you. And that's all I have as far as sort of an introduction to Mercersburg. That really just scrapes the surface. So I certainly, if you haven't done so, encourage you to go to our website to learn more. We just added this section that you can see here under the admission tab. The Get to Know Us page has a lot of really good virtual content. That's where our virtual tour is that I was on earlier. There's a video virtual tour that's up there that actually a lot of our Chinese students threw together while they were staying here over spring break, while the coronavirus outbreak was still bad in China, but not so bad here. We knew that we were going to have to develop something virtual, so we grabbed some of our Chinese students to help us do a virtual video tour of campus. So big, big kudos to those kids who helped us. But there's a lot of really good virtual content on there that I encourage you to take a look at.
这里的老师他分享了学校的一个网站链接，就是如果说我们对于这个学校想要了解更多的话，非常 非常建议我们能够登录学校的这个官网，就是在这个屏幕上方有个红色箭头这儿，它有一个线上的一个访校链接，大家可以通过这个链接更好的去看到这个学校。那不管是学校的各方面的设施，还是一些其他的一些信息，都可以通过这个页面了解得更加清楚。
All right, great. Now I'm going to stop sharing my screen here because that's all I have. Before we open it up to questions for everybody, there I do have a couple of questions here that I know are top of mind for some of you that I'm going to go ahead and answer. Number one being about placement tests, SSAT and TOEFL, I know have been canceled for the next few months. And are we going to accept any other language proficiency or standardized tests? Keep in mind, we're not going to let a global pandemic prevent you from applying to Mercersburg Academy. We're going to do everything in our power to make sure to remove any of those hurdles as we can. So yes, we are going to be flexible when it comes to standardized tests. We do accept the IELTS, which I know students, some students already submit. But you know, whatever barriers are in front of you from being able to complete the TOEFL, we're going to work with you on that. It'll be very much on a case-by-case basis, probably. We have yet to put forth any kind of official policy. It's one of those things that we're very much paying attention to as it develops. But bear in mind, we're not going to let that prevent you from completing an application here. And we do feel very confident in the SSAT online test, which is scheduled to be rolled out this summer. We intend to start accepting that as soon as it's available to families.
嗯，在疫情期间呢，很多家长他会问到招生办这边一个问题，就是说，那如果我没有办法去参加那些考试的话，那会不会影响我们的申请？那这个答案是否定的，因为每一个学生他们的申请 case 都会被学生被学校非常慎重的去看待。那如果说学生因为没有办法参加某一些考试而递交这个成绩的话，那学校他也会和学生一起去看能够有哪一些替代性的考试。那比如说像有一些孩子他因为没有办法参加托福考试的话，那学校也是愿意接受雅思成绩的。那另外呢SSAT 考试的，因为现在也推出了线上版，所以如果说这个成绩出来的话，学校他也是会愿意去以这样子的一个分数作为他参考的一个依据的。所以总之就是学校希望学生不用太担心因为疫情影响到了参加考试而会被学校在申请这一块会有一些不方便的一些看待，这个是不用太担心的。
Thank you. And I know on a similar note, many families are concerned about whether or not they'll actually be able to come to campus and visit us in the fall. What should they do about that? As I mentioned earlier, I encourage you to take advantage of our website and all of the virtual content that we've produced in the last couple of months. We are planning to continue to develop a virtual experience over the summer to roll out in the fall. No matter what happens, I mean, whether or not we're on campus or virtual, we still intend to create a virtual experience for anybody to have as an option. And that's, of course, still being developed, but we'll send that stuff out as it's produced. But in the meantime, certainly take advantage of the virtual content that is already available on our website. As I said, we have videos and testimonials from faculty and parents, students on there. We have virtual tours on there, PDF materials of print materials that you would normally find on campus. All of those are on our website now. So take advantage of it if you're able to.
然后另外呢，也会有一些家长就问到，因为现在因为疫情的关系，那学生和家庭可能没有办法那么方便的去到访校。那学校在这一块的话，也是会在夏季的时候提供一个线上访校的一个机会的。那学生也可以通过这样子的一个机会去更好的去了解这个学校。那除此之外，老师他也非常建议我们的家庭能够充分利用学校目前在网站上已经有的那些资源，去看一下就是在各个方面能够更好的去了解这个学校。
And I will note that if families are not able to make it to campus in the fall,that we'll continue to do these kinds of virtual webinars. We'll host our own Zoom webinars for families to attend. So we will make sure there are opportunities for you to ask questions and get to meet some of the people of Mercersburg.
然后呢，在此之外呢，学校它也会让自己就是学校会有很多的机会让学生和家庭如果有任何的问题的话都可以通过各种各样的方式去问到学校。学校他也会通过各种方式来给学生和家庭提供他们尽可能满意的一个回答。
All right, thank you. Now, I'm happy to take any other questions or open it up. Sandy, I'll let you take the lead on that.
Okay, sure. Thank you, Jay. Yeah, first of all, thank you so much for all the detail and comprehensive presentation. And you actually answer many of the questions that our parents ask. And Mercersburg has done a great job in doing all the virtual experience. And the virtual tour you just showed was just great. It's just exactly the same as what I saw on campus. Yeah.During the visit. So thank you, Jake. And there are a few other questions that our families would like to know more. And yes, one question is about the AP. So I understand that starting from this fall, Mercersburg will be moving away from the AP experience. Can you explain like more about the reason behind this decision and how this would affect the course offerings at Mercersburg?
Yeah, absolutely. We're not the only school doing this. We're actually joining a group of schools, many top independent schools in the United States who are also moving away from, I should say, moving beyond the AP. We receive a lot of feedback from faculty, teachers who teach AP courses that it's very restrictive because...they're such skilled teachers and they have such a wealth of knowledge, but they're unable to fully tap into that because they're restricted to what the AP and College Board are mandating them teach. So instead of doing traditional AP courses, we'll be developing our own advanced curriculum. And that's, we've actually heard a lot of feedback from colleges that they don't really care about APs.They care about what are the most advanced courses that your students are taking. The AP designation doesn't matter. So we're going to continue to offer courses that are at the AP level and even higher, but they're just not the actual College Board AP classes. And this will give our school and our faculty more opportunities to create classesthat are college level, but aren't even offered within the College Board or AP curriculums. So based on feedback from our teachers, as well as colleges and other schools who have done this, we are confident that moving in this direction will be in the best interest for our students while they're here, but also in terms of college placement.
这个问题呢，就是有一些家长就会问，因为从今年的这个秋季开始 ，Mercersburg 这个学校他已经宣布了就会取消正式的取消 AP 课程。那这个问题就是说，想要了解一下学校他正式取消 AP 课程之后的原因，还有就是这样会不会影响到Mercersburg 相关的课程的一个提供？那老师的回答是这样的，首先从第一方面讲的话。 Mercersburg 这个学校它不是第一家学校正式的把 AP 课程取消的，其实很多的顶尖美高都已经开始或者说已经做了这样子一个进程很多年了，那所以说它不是第一家。那第二的就是说为什么会有这样子的一个改变吧，那因为很多的老师特别是教 AP 课程的老师他都有反映说，因为 AP 课程的他是要严格按照 College Board 他的一个课程教授方面的一些限制的，所以说老师是在课堂的设计方面就会感觉到有一些受限，这样其实会影响到老师他在课堂上的一个创造力，包括学生他的一个非常就是根据学生不同能力来授课的这样子的一个比较好的情况吧。所以说如果学校他把这个 AP 课程改成了本校的一个校本课程，然后这个课程他可以根据老师他当时的这个情况，当时这个学生的情况，还有对于这个课程的一个把握，来调整他的难度的话，那这个其实对于老师来说，对于学生来说都是更有益的。然后另外一方面，从大学的录取这一块来看的话，其实很多的大学它现在也不会是完完全全拘泥于这个 AP 课程的开设了，他们其实会更加关心的就是这个学校它在相关的科目领域有哪一些更加先进的一些课程，更加难的一些课程可以提供给到这个学生。所以这个是从大学录取的角度来看的话， AP 课程的取消不但不会影响学生去申请大学，反倒从某个意义上讲的话更有利于让学生和老师比较灵活的去学习这门课，然后也让大学那一方面更好的去了解这个学生和这个学校他能够提供的课程的一个难度。所以从这点上看的话，学校对于这一方面的一个改变还是持乐观态度的。
Thank you. And I actually just, in the chat box, I just posted a resource, a link to our website, which has more information as well as a list of frequently asked questions about this decision specifically. So if you're interested in learning more about it, you'll find a lot of information right there.
然后另外在学校的这个官网上，应该是在招生的 admissions 那个链接下面，学校它有列出一些就是以往的家庭它问的比较多的一些问题，然后也有非常详细的一个答案，所以也欢迎我们的家长如果对学校更加感兴趣的话，可以登录到这个学校的网站链接看看有没有什么自己想要问的这个问题是已经被之前的家长问到过的，上面会有非常详细的答案。
Okay, thank you, Jake. So some parents would also like to know more about the capstone experience. So as you mentioned, each student at Mercersburg will be required to do either the maps or like the springboard. Can you like explain a bit more about like the two programs and like what are some of the examples that like our students have done?
Yeah, absolutely. MAPS stands for Mercersburg Advanced Programs for Global Studies. And the second capstone program is Springboard. They're two very different programs, so I'll explain them one at a time. MAPS, we'll start there. MAPS is a very rigorous program that you have to apply for. Only 15 to 18 students are selected. And it's actually a two-year program that starts your 11th grade year and concludes your senior year. It's a lot of the work involved is independent research because what the goal is to identify some kind of global issue, but on a very micro scale. And then you spend your 2 years studying that issue. And then you consult with experts, outside experts, who help you essentially write what is a 40 to 50 page research paper. And then you have to do a 30 to 45 minute presentation in front of the community about your topic of research. Students often study social justice issues in the world, mental health issues in the world, various crises that are happening at government levels in the world. And they're essentially asked to propose a plan for addressing that problem. There are a few requirements to it. You have to take the highest level of your language that you're in. You have to travel globally, whether that's with the school or on your own. You have to go on some kind of international travel experience. Those are the two main components that come with it. And as I said, it begins your 11th grade year and ends your senior year. And a lot of the work that they're doing is very high level university work, if not higher, which is why you're asked to apply for it and why it's so selective. So that's MAPS, and that's one option for Capstone. And I'll let you go ahead and explain that one, Angela, if you'd like. I just threw a lot at you.
Okay. 问题呢，就是因为学校的话，它有两个特色项目，这两个特色项目必须要完成其中一个，它才可以毕业。分别是 MAPS 还有 Springboard。那 MAPS 的它的全称呢是这个 Mercersburg Advanced Program for Global Studies， 翻译成中文的话就是全球的一个研究高级项目。那刚才老师先就是只详细介绍的就是这个 MAPS 的项目，他之后也会介绍一下 Springboard 另外这个项目。那我们现在先看一看这个 MAPS 它到底是什么样的一个项目吧。它是非常有特色的，它其实是为期两年，从11年级开始就要去提前申请。然后在这个项目当中，学生要至少完成150个小时的社区服务，然后有至少有四周的时间要出国学习，然后并且和另外一个国家的住家去相处。那这个项目的目的就是说要帮助学生成为一个有创造力的、有这个洞察力的一个思考者，还有是一个富有同情心、愿意去参与各个方面的一个全球公民，同时呢也是一个独立自主的学习者。那在这个项目当中，学生要完成一个叫 search 的项目，那其中呢就包括了要写一篇分析性的研究论文，然后还要有一个社区的参与提案，还要向这个我们的专业人士专家小组去介绍自己所做的项目。那这个项目的报告是要有大概45分钟的。对，所以说这个项目它对于学生成熟度的一个培养，还有全球公民性质的这方面的培养是非常有帮助的，然后同时也达到了一个大学的水平。
Thank you. Yeah, so the other option for Capstone is Springboard. As I said, you have to pick one or the two. You have to pick MAPS or Springboard. Most of our students wind up doing Springboard because you don't have to apply for it. And if you don't get MAPS, then obviously you have to take Springboard. Now, with Springboard, there are 8 different courses that count as your Springboard class. And one of the differences between MAPS and Springboard is a year-long course. It's not 2 years. So it only happens during your senior year. But the courses are really cool that you can take for Springboard. They're very non-traditional. And it's a similar model in that you're expected to spend the year working on a project that you have to present at the end of the year. And for Springboard 2, you work with outside experts to develop your project. Now, some of the classes that you can take as your Springboard course include entrepreneurship, where you spend the year essentially as an entrepreneur creating a business idea and a business plan, and you work with local business leaders to help you develop that plan into something. App design, where you spend the year programming and developing an app for iOS, actually. We have Fight Against Disease, where you spend the year researching diseases and pandemics. You know, this is quite a year to be taking that class. We have a number of people, alumni, connected to the Center for Disease Control, so our students were able to work with them on their projects. write your novel, where you spend the year writing a play or a novel or a short story that you then present at the end of the year, and Maker's Lab even, where you spend the year in the Maker's Lab building something. And we've had students build airplane prototypes. They've built Bluetooth speakers. They've built robotic arms and limbs, cool things like that. So those are a number of the springboard classes that students can take.
这个老师他有介绍 Springboard 这个跳板项目他的一些具体的情况。那这个项目它其实和刚才我们提到的 MAPS 项目相比的话，有更多的学生参加。一方面它是为期只需要一年，也就是12年级的学生参加的一个项目，而且他也不用提前去申请。所以说他从这个角度上来讲的话，参加的人数会更多一些。那尽管说每一个跳板项目它在主题上面都是不同的，他们的目标其实都是一样的，也就是他们要深入研究一个主题，提出问题，然后通过这个钻研问题来获取到这个相关的知识，最后要做一个非常完善的一个演示，由专家小组去进行评估。那这个项目呢，就鼓励学生去进行批判性的思维，看看怎么样更好的去发现问题、解决问题，并且去面对各种各样的挑战，或者说在某一个项目上面去思考怎么样去做到更好的一个提升。那从项目的主题上面，老师刚才给了一些例子，比如说有这个创业性的项目，有商业艺术，或者说是通过这个播客去讲故事，甚至有一些孩子他是会通过一个创新型的项目来去向大家介绍就是自己在某一些问题上面的一个研究。
Thank you. Actually, one of our students, Selena, I know that she did the maps, and I actually watched her virtual presentations about DNA and then combining with the business side. So it was a very advanced project.
Yeah.
Sure. So Jay, there are two more questions from the parents. So the one that the parents would like to know is about the community service experience. So can you talk more about this opportunities?
Yeah, of course. Community service at Mercersburg is something that's offered in the afternoon as an extracurricular program that you can sign up for. If you don't want to do a sport, or if you don't want to do outdoor ed or dance or theater, community service is a great option. It's not required, but it is available for students who want to participate. So every afternoon, you leave campus and you go off to a different site within the Mercersburg community specifically, as well as kind of the surrounding area out in town. Some of the places they visit are after school daycares for young children, little kids whose parents are still working, but that's where they go after school until they're picked up. So our students will go tutor them, help them with homework, play on the playground with them. It's a great way for our kids to end the day. They do things around town, like helping build gardens or helping with sidewalk repair projects in town. We help local area elderly residents with projects around their own house that they need help with. And there are a number of different things. At the beginning of each year, we kind of, the community service program assesses what are the needs in the community right now. And depending on what those are, that's what the community service program looks like for the year. So depending on the year, it kind of evolves a little bit, which is neat. It keeps it fresh for every student. It's not going to be the same community service experience every year. And it's offered all three seasons. So you can do it in the fall, winter, and spring if you'd like. There are lots of opportunities to get involved.
这个问题呢，就是有一些家长会问到学校他在社区服务这方面会给学生提供什么样的一个资源。那老师有回答说，就是每一天下午呢，其实学校都会鼓励一些孩子去参加相关的社区服务。当然这个不是必选的。 那有一些孩子也会利用下午的时间去参加各种各样的社团呢、啊、或者说参与体育艺术音乐方面的一些课程或者锻炼吧。那如果说这个孩子他对社区服务很感兴趣或者说想要尝试的话呢，那学校也会有比较多的资源和项目可以给到学生去做选择。当然这个每一年都会不一样，学校在每一年的时候他都会去了解一下身边这个社区他都会有哪一些公益活动公益服务是需要的，这样子的话可以提供给自己的孩子。那比如说像今年的话，那就有一些孩子他会在下午放学之后去到身边的这些社区去照顾孩子。那这些孩子可能爸爸妈妈本身是还在上班，没有办法去到幼儿园或者学校把这个孩子给接出来，那我们的学生呢就会在这一方面担起责任来，把这个孩子接出来之后呢，他会去在作业上面呢去给孩子提供一些辅导，然后也会跟孩子们一起玩，直到他们把他们送回到自己父母的手里。那另外呢，也会比如说帮助一些社区里面的老人修剪他们的花园，帮他们进行房屋的打扫啊等等。那另外也是就有时候他们这个社区的一些人行道需要一些修葺，可能会需要一些志愿者，那这个时候学生他也会在这一块去提供相应的帮助。总之就是学校他在社区服务这一块他会尽他们所能的给学生提供各种各样的资源，那只要学生他有心的话都是可以去参加的。
Okay, thank you.And Angela. So the last question from the parents is not like specifically about Mercersburg, but like a parent would like to know. So there are so many like great boarding schools in the States. So Jake, do you have any advice for families on how to choose the best fit and how to choose the right option for their kids?
Oh yeah, that's a great question. And it's a question that'll have a little bit of a different answer this year, I feel like, especially because, you know, my immediate answer is always going to be visit the schools. And then while, you know, when you're on campus, ask yourself, do I see myself here? Does this place feel like home to me? But I know there's a lot of uncertainty as to whether or not students will be able to visit and actually experience campus. And for those students, I encourage you to fully take advantage of the admission office and the connections that they have to the school. And Mercersburg, for example, is we're the kind of school that like whatever you need, and this is how most boarding schools are gonna be, to be perfectly honest. Whatever you need in order to make a good informed decision, whoever you need to talk to, whether that's a parent or a current student or a teacher or a coach, we're gonna connect you with that person. And as we venture into this uncharted territory, all of these schools are gonna be ready and excited to connect you with people virtually. And to get a feel for what a school is and what school might be a good fit for you, it's important that you get to know its people, because the people are the things that make a community what it is. So if you're not able to actually make it to campus, I encourage you, whether it's me or another member of the Mercersburg admission office or the admission office at another school, ask them to connect you with people on campus so that you can talk to those people and learn about their authentic experiences at the school, because that'll be the next best thing to visiting campus. There's nothing, you know, coronavirus is not going to stop you from being able to connect with the people. It might stop you from visiting campus, but a school's community will still be more than willing and excited to talk to you and answer your questions. So take advantage of that. Whatever school it may be that you're applying to, make sure you ask your admission officer to connect you with some of the people there.
最后一个问题就是有一个家长问呢，在目前这个情况下，那我们如何在众多的美高当中去选择自己最适合的？当然这个问题它不是仅仅局限于 Mercersburg， 他就希望说 Jack 老师他能够从一个比较资深的招生官的角度去给一些建议，我们如何在这么多很好、很优秀、很优质的美高当中去选择自己最适合的那一个？因为毕竟高中不是终点，我们怎么样能够让孩子在这高中的四年充分的去发挥自己的潜能，找到自己，最终去到一个理想大学，这个才是最重要的。那这一方面呢，老师也给了一个非常中肯的回答。就如果是以往的话，往年他给的这个答案可能是，那你一定要来参观这个学校，你只有参观了这个学校之后，你才会对这个学校有非常全面的又有个体化的一个了解，这样子的话才有利于你这个学生去做选择。那另外呢，我们在这个参观校园的这个过程当中，也要不断的去问自己一个问题，就是说我能够在这个学校看到我自己的吗？我的这个身影，我觉得能够在学校看到吗？这个学校适合我吗？这个是我们在访校的时候会建议学生不断去门问自己的一个回答。那因为这个是过往在没有疫情的情况下，那访校是一个很好的一个解决方式。那在现在今年这个比较特殊的情况下，当访校已经有可能会存在一些阻碍的话，那他的这个答案有一些新的变化了。那就是说他希望学生和家庭能够充分的利用这个学校招生办的资源，就和这个学校的招生办取得联系，或者说和自己的顾问，比如说像 foundation 上的顾问机构取得去了解这个学校他哪一些方面的人是自己最想去和他们进行沟通的。比如说如果他在这个孩子在运动或者说音乐等等各方面有一些自己的特长和优势的话，他可以要求foundation 联系这个学校的 admissions， 就是这个学校的招生办，去和学校相关的这个教员或者说教练取得联系，看看能不能够在这个运动或者说音乐等相关的这个领域可以和他们有进一步的一个沟通。那另外呢，也可以和学校的老师啊，或者说在校的学生，甚至是以往的校友去进行这个一个联系吧。因为有一些家庭他们可能没有，就自己本身没有相关的资源，所以在这一块话也不用太担心，因为不管是顾问老师还是学校的招生办，他们永远都会在旁边，都会给学生给家庭提供这个相关的资源。那只有说我们和自己最关心的项目相关的那个人有了非常非常就是明确的一个沟通，非常好的一个交流之后，那我们对这个学校相关的领域自己感兴趣的方面才会有一个更好的答案。那这样对于我们去做选择到底自己最适合哪一个学校也是非常有帮助的。因为这个确实一个学校它最重要的不是它的硬件设施，而是它的人。所以它的人是什么样的一个特点，什么样的一个风格，那它能够给我们带来什么样不同的影响，这个才是对于我们来说选校最重要的一个环节。
Thank you. So yeah, thank you Jake and Angela. That's all the question we have. And thank you again for Jake taking time to talk to us and our families today. And it's certainly very helpful. And yeah, hopefully we will be able to see you on campus or in Asia very soon after the pandemic is over.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, it's my pleasure. And thank you guys for the opportunity. And I look forward to hopefully getting to meet many of you parents and students on here in the coming weeks or months, whether that's virtually or in person. I do work with many of our Chinese and international students. So chances are, if you do apply to Mercersburg, then we'll get to work together pretty closely. And I look forward to that opportunity for sure. So thank you so much, Sandy. I appreciate it. And Angela, thank you for translating.
Thank you. Thank you. You're welcome.
Thank you. 大家，今天就到此为止了。Thank you, Jake. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.